Hello, everybody. This is Holy Kaika again. Now, today, my special guest, you know, is really interesting because, you know, he was raised pretty much most of his life on the mainland. But this guy is more deep into the Hawaiian culture than a lot of other brothers I know that live here locally in Hawaii, especially me. He knows more about it than me, too, even though I've lived there all my life.
Not either.
No, even, bro. His dad is a legend in Kumuhula, you know, entertainer and whatnot. And the whole family, the Kelly family, has been known for their skills in the arts, especially with music and with Polynesian dance. And that's actually how I met him, was through doing some of the Polynesian luau's up at BYU, and became friends. And he's part of that whole HD crew I talked about before, too, in some of the previous episodes. And so I'm going to introduce you folks to him, and he's going to tell you a little bit more about himself and his life story. So, ladies and gentlemen, my man, Pono Kelly. Brother, if you could please go ahead and introduce yourself.
Hey, thanks, Gabon. So I'm kind of happy that you're doing this. I think this is a great thing, always to help those who are trying to be better. So thank you. But just to tell you a little bit about how I started, you know, I grew up in Utah. I was born and raised in Utah, and growing up was kind of hard for me because I had a hard time going to school, and you know, I had to sit there and be quiet and all this stuff, and going through elementary with just Hali people was kind of hard for me. So, you know, I was raised, but my dad, he mostly spoke Pidgin to me. So that's kind of how I was raised speaking. And then I go to school and I try to say, like, I need to throw away rubbish, or, you know, where's the rubbish can or whatever. And my teachers would look at me funny and like, what's that? You know, and you know, it was kind of hard trying to figure out who I was, my identity and whatnot. But I had a hard time. It was kind of funny because my dad, he always tried to surround himself with many local people. So on our street, there was about 5 houses on each side of the street. And within those 10 houses or so, there was 4 Hawaiian families, like big families. Ned Aikau, the Sings were up the road, Danny Aina, and then our family. We were all on the same street. And so we kind of lived in a kind of a Hawaiian section of all of Utah. You know, it's kind of crazy. So when I was growing up, you know, I would get licking from Uncle Ned sometimes for, you know, just doing dumb stuff or whatever, and vice versa. All his kids, my dad would talk to them too. So it was kind of crazy growing up. But I was pretty much raised in the Hawaiian culture. And it was kind of hard because, you know, I would go play football, and then my coaches would say, hey, how come you're late? And I would have to tell them, oh, I was at hula practice. And I was kind of ashamed about that, you know, because people would be laughing at me for dancing hula or whatever. And so it kind of made it hard for me to appreciate the culture and want to be like proud of who I was. And so that was kind of a hard thing until I hit probably about 7th grade. Danny Aina moved into the area, and he asked me if I wanted to learn how to lift weights. And I was just a small guy, you know. I was just you know, at first I was real skinny, and then I got kind of fat. I was a chubby boy, and then he asked me if I wanted to lift weights. I started lifting weights. I started loving it. And he helped me. He fostered that in me because he saw that I really liked it, and I was dedicated to do it. And I got strong really fast. And by the time I was in 7th, going on 8th grade, I was pretty strong. And by then, people started looking at me like, wow, this kid is pretty big, and don't mess with him, you know? So it kind of, that's where I started to build a little bit more confidence. And of course, when I was younger, you know, Bruce Lee, all the Bruce Lee movies came out, and I was just like, oh yeah. People were kind of making fun of me for being kind of Asian or you know, Chinese eyes and whatnot. And it was kind of a place where there's a lot of racial things going on. And it was, you know, I remember even later on in high school, I was being profiled, you know, by cops. They were like, you know, we'd be just out hanging out and cops would come out in like three or four, you know, cars. And then they would just come out and harass us. And, you know, they would tell us, hey, you guys need to leave. And we'd get up and get off the chairs that we were on. And they'd be like, oh, how are we going to get these brown stains off now? So, you know, I had to deal with that kind of stuff growing up. And it was kind of hard. And, you know, I didn't have a lot of confidence because of that. And people would make fun of the way I talked or, you know, the way I spoke because I was still using a lot of Pidgin. And I was, you know, it was hard to go back and forth. You know, I grew up in kind of that situation. That was kind of my upbringing. But, you know, people like Danny Aina, who was like real good mentors and actually, you know, seemed to care a lot about me, made me feel like I could do things. And, you know, I always struggled with English. You know, that was probably the one class that I was always failing for some reason.
Me too, brother.
you know, my first F I got in high school was in English, and boy, I caught pretty dirty lickings for that. You know, it was a big deal because my parents, my mom especially, she wanted me to do good in school, but you know, it was just, I don't know, I just felt like I wasn't confident enough. I had a hard time speaking. You know, it was really, really difficult. But as I got older, I went to college and, you know, I just never thought I could do it on my own. And so, you know, I found myself, you know, cheating off other kids and just not feeling like I was smart enough. And you know, then I got into college. I started like thinking, oh, maybe I can do it. So I started doing stuff on my own. Like, okay, I'm gonna try to study. I'm going to try to write this paper. You know, I was like having some girls help me write papers because I was struggling so bad. But eventually I take this English class in college and I start writing my own papers. And the teacher was like so awesome. You know, she was just such a good mentor about helping me to feel comfortable with my English. And so she helped me with that. And all the papers I wrote, she like really took me aside and like she critiqued them in a way that made me feel good. And so that's another thing that helped me. As you know, I went to school with Martin Palmer. I went to dental school with Martin Palmer. And man, me and him, after I graduated from college, you know, I was I had been working in the juvenile court system, and I think you can remember we played volleyball there. You came, man. You came and played, but I was the supervisor over there, and I would bring as many people in as I could. I think I got Mike Palmer was working there, Shannon Hondo was working there. I think Russ and a whole bunch of other people that we got in. But, man, we made it like it was a lot of fun. You know, it was just like working and having fun. But it was kind of like one Hawaiian crew we had over there. But as I was doing that, and that was kind of my job going through college. But when we got out of that, I got married and I moved to Hawaii. Thinking, oh, I'm never leaving, you know. So now I know I'm skipping some steps, but you know, I wanted to live in Hawaii. That was kind of my goal. And after I got married, we moved to Hawaii, and you know, just moved everything, but it just somehow just never worked out. And so I came back. We had our first baby, and went back to work in the juvenile system. And I was just like, oh, man, we gotta try one more time. Let's move back to Hawaii. So me and my wife, we had our first baby. We said, okay, let's move back. We moved back. Cassie finished her undergrad while we were there. And just the whole time, we were just barely making it, you know? It was really hard to make it and survive over there. And we had our second baby over there. And so we had two kids. I was working a job with a degree in a bachelor's in science in sociology, which was kind of a waste time degree, right? It didn't really help me. But I was working in a place called Bobby Benson Center, working with delinquent kids, kids that were abused, who had a hard time, you know, were either abused by their parents or whatnot, or with alcohol and drugs. And so I really had a good time working there, but was just never enough to pay the bills, you know? So I said, okay, well, maybe what I got to do is go back, and I gotta go back to school, because the only way I'm going to live in Hawaii is if I go back to school and I'm able to get a better job. So I went back and I told myself, hey, you know, I got to go back to school and I got to do it on my own. I got to get this done, you know? So I put my head down and I took all these hard classes. I took three really hard classes at one time. I took physics, I took anatomy, and I took chemistry all at the same time. And it was hard. And actually, it wasn't chemistry, it was physiology. But really hard classes. And I was putting in like 16-hour days just trying to see if I had to prove to myself that I could get through these classes, because I thought, if I can't do these classes without, you know, any help, you know, without, you know, just basically cheating, you know, just I had to do it on my own. So I tried to prove it to myself. And, you know, I put in a lot of work and it was hard, but I got through it. And by the end of that semester, I was one of the top scoring students in the anatomy class. Me and Martin Palmer, we took that class together. And that, well, working with him the whole time, you know, really boosted my confidence in being able to know that I'm good, like I'm smart enough. And, you know, it was actually pretty much a miracle that I ended up in dental school with Martin, because, I mean, the odds of getting in were pretty hard. They're pretty big. And yeah, it really was a miracle. But I think together we both applied to like 11 schools. Martin, he was on his way. He was doing good. You know, he had been trying to get in for some time now. And me, I was trying to get in like, I don't know, I was like 6 months trying to get in, you know, whatever. And by the time I hit 8 months, I was accepted to dental school. And it happened really fast. And people were like, wow, that's crazy. It's crazy. So, you know, I ended up going to school with them. We worked together. We were partners in the dental school. We were doing everything, you know, to get all the credits and all the things that we needed to finish dental school. We did together. And I was just super confident after going through all the classes, because we went through our prereq classes and courses, and we did all that together too. So, you know, it was great having another Hawaiian over there helping me get through. So we kind of succeeded together. And, you know, it was kind of, honestly, it was a miracle, and Martin can attest to that. But yeah, now I've been working as a dentist. I've had a couple of jobs where I was a director, and you know, I'm just trying to get back to Hawaii. But the whole time, just to rewind a little bit, as soon as I finished dental school, I went and did a residency in Waimanalo. And I did one whole year over there. And then they said, okay, well, you gotta get a job, because I had got this scholarship that says I gotta work in a health center, and you gotta obtain a job if you wanna stay here. And there was no jobs at that time when I finished my residency. There was no jobs for me to even take. So, you know, I kind of just was praying about it and trying to figure out, oh, what am I gonna do? Because I gotta pay back all my debt from school, and I gotta get a job, because there's no way I can survive without a job. There's just no way. And just one thing happened and led to another, and ended up two jobs had popped up. One was in Hana on Maui, and then another job on Molokai. And I went to each place, I interviewed, and of course they wanted me bad because I was Hawaiian, you know, I was, and they wanted me to take over their dental department.
And how often do you see a Hawaiian dentist? Yeah. How often?
I don't know. I mean, me and Martin, I don't know.
Right.
Get a couple often. Others, but you know, yeah. Not too often. Right. So, I get the interview, and I interview at both places, and they both want me to come work for them. And so I use that to kind of like boost the pay, right? Because I said, oh, these guys want to help me. They want to give me more money. So the other one said, okay, I'll give you more money, whatever. But ended up going with Molokai Health Center. And I get there. You know, I call the state, right? The state licensing. I tell them, hey, I got this job offer. I just need to get my license. And what do I need to do? They said, I took this test. I told them I failed one part of it. And I said, can I work in a health center? Because I had a California license. Excuse me. And they said, yeah, you can. And so I told the CEO at Molokai Health Center, yeah, they said I could work here with my California license. So they moved me from Oahu to Molokai, and we're over there living. And then I turn in the paperwork, and the state comes back and says, oh, you failed that part of the test. You can't get a license. So I was distraught, man. I was like, what am I going to do? I got my whole family. By then, we had six kids, right? We had five kids. And we had moved my whole family over there. And I couldn't work because I couldn't get my license. So I had people from, I had Ostander. He was the leader for Huihana. And I had people from the mayor's office, people from Senator Schatz's office, and they were all trying to help me get my license, because I only failed the test by one percentage point. And you needed a 75, I got a 74. But anyway, I was there for 6 months, and you know, we would fly from Molokai to Oahu to talk to the state licensing department for dental, and just try to plead my case and try to get them to let me work in this office in Molokai. But it just never worked out, you know? So here we are 10 years later, right? And just this past August, you know, the whole time, within 10 years, I'm like, oh, I don't like it here as much, right? I kept thinking to myself, I'd rather be in Hawaii. In this last August, my daughter, she got accepted to go to BYU Hawaii, and I ended up taking her to Hawaii. And I took my two little boys, because they had never really experienced Hawaii. So I took them, And in within 1 week, we were having so much fun, you know, just going to all the places, getting shaved by ice and going to the beaches and whatnot, and just hanging out with friends. And, you know, just everything was just awesome. And, you know, Martin actually came. So we hung out a little bit too. And I just told Martin, I said, hey, we got to come back. We got to get back. And I said, and as soon as I got home to California, I started studying for the test and ended up just really putting my head down and just studying hard. But knowing that in my mind, I thought, well, I gotta take everything over. Like there's a hands-on section you have to take where you have to go in people's mouth and do the fillings and stuff and all these other parts, which were pretty difficult. I mean, it's easy, but the dental work's easy, but you got to find patients. You got to put them up in a hotel, things like that. But anyway, I took the test. It was the written test, and I ended up passing it. And then I'm just trying to figure out how I'm going to pass the other stuff because it's going to be pretty difficult, right? But then I go back online. I actually end up calling one lady at the office where they set up the test. And she said, well, where are you trying to work? Where are you trying to get a license? And I said, in Hawaii. Well, why don't you just apply? Like, just send it in. You can talk to the state over there and see what they say, but you've pretty much passed everything. And I was like kind of shocked. So I'm at this point right now where I can see the light at the end of the tunnel. I might be able to work in Hawaii, right? So, but I'm really not getting all of the details. I mean, it is kind of more than that. I mean, it was pretty difficult this last 10 years and then going through school, you know, ever since 2008, you know, me and Martin, we've been working to try to get to Hawaii. And it's kind of been our dream together, you know, and to get our families there and to work over there, to help the brothers that, like, you're trying to help them, you know. I think that's the, you know, I think for me growing up, I was just struggling, you know. I mean, I get puka teeth, you know. I get problems with my teeth because I was kind of in the same similar situation where I was embarrassed, you know. And I didn't want to go places and show people my teeth and stuff, but you know, it's, I mean, I know how Polynesians are. I know how Hawaiians are. They're proud, right? They don't want people to know that they got issues or problems, and I didn't either. And you know, I think that was one of the main things. Martin and I, we wanted to help those people. And as a resident, when I was in Hawaii working on Waimanalo, man, I just tried my best to make people feel like, hey, I'm not here to judge you. You know, I'm here to help you. I want to help you. And I'm going to do everything I can to help you. I don't care if you have no money. I'm here to help you. So, you know, it was probably one of the best experiences I've had working as a dentist. Since then, I've been working in all these other health centers, and it's just kind of like on the go. Like, I feel like I'm just a machine, just working, you know. But when I was over there, I felt like I was doing it because I wanted to help the Hawaiian people, and you know, it just is different, you know, here. So with that, I mean, I just hope that I can establish this license so I can either. You know, there's a lot of things at play here. I got my two boys. They just finished their sophomore and junior. They're in their sophomore and junior year. So, you know, it's kind of hard for me to say I'm going to pull them out of school and you know, in their last year of high school. And they're doing so good, you know. So a lot of things I got to think about. But, you know, to all the brothers out there, you know, I want to help anybody however I can, just like what you're doing, you know. I can see that through some of these videos that you just want to want to strengthen the Hawaiian community by sending out these videos, making people stronger. And to me, that's one step up. You know, we need more people that are going to be able to just reach down and help those who are in need. And, you know, I'd like to be a part of that. So, you know, that's one of the reasons I'm here with you tonight. So, did you have any other interview questions or things you wanted to ask?
Bro, the chicken skin, really. That whole story you told. Oh man, I didn't even have to ask you one question, man. You covered all. You covered everything, brother. You know, I while you were talking, I was just thinking. You know who Amin Kao is?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. You talk story with him every once in a while.
I haven't spoken with him since I was, because me and him, we were actually in the residency together.
Okay.
He was actually doing his pedo. He was working with the kids. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. That's cool. No, I was just wondering because I know he's working as a dentist on Big Island right now. So yeah, if maybe talking to him might be a good thing. He can get you maybe the ins on some stuff and what's going on as well. But I got maybe a major chicken skin. Just hearing your whole story, bro. I can tell by your body language, your voice, how passionate you are about helping our brothers, you know, all the Kanakas that are struggling out here, you know. And, you know, I think Martin and I had a discussion, too. A lot of times when some of these guys that get involved with drugs and abusing drugs can affect their teeth pretty badly, you know, and a lot of them no more. And I can imagine a lot of them not being shamed to go show up to the dentist because of certain reasons or whatnot. But the fact that you and Martin are guys that can understand and be like, hey, bro, no worry. You know, just come in. We'll take care of you, bro. You know, that's cool. That's really cool. They need that. They're going to need that kind of help over here. Because, go ahead. What were you going to say?
No, I always think about how can you get a job? You know, how can you get a job? You get puketeed. You get, you know, problems with your teeth and you know, you can't smile, you know, whatever, you know, it makes it hard.
Yeah.
Living in Hawaii is going to be hard already. You know, I already know that. I mean, the economy is so rough and our next generation's coming up, you know, our kids, how are they going to be able to survive, you know, with the amount of, you know, cost for living, you know, I don't know how they're going to do it.
Yeah.
You know, we have to pay $500,000-$600,000 just to find a small house.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's just no way. I don't know how they think we're going to be able to survive. The Hawaiians, you know, there's so many problems with Hawaiians not being able to make it as it is. You got to live in a multifamily home.
Yeah.
You know, everyone's got to be working. Husband, wife got to be working just to make it. So, I kind of fear for the future, you know, I just worry. But, you know, that's why I try to do the best I can to help my kids, teach them, you know. I don't try to do any work for them. I try to get them to do the work and try to lift them up by being kind of strict. You know, growing up, I know you talked about lick-ins and stuff like that on the show, but man, I know you know my dad. Everyone thinks he was so nice, huh? But
yes, I do.
Inside the house, oh man, when I was younger, I was the one getting the most dirty lickings because I was one naughty boy.
I remember the stories. I remember you telling me the stories.
Yeah, but you know, I was just the other day I was talking to my daughter, Kea. She's the one at BYU. Hawaii, and she was just here washing the dishes. I said, hey, what you're gonna, I don't know how it came up, but we were talking about, she was saying, my kids are gonna be good. And I go, well, how are they gonna be good? You're not gonna give them licking. And she goes, Dad, I'm gonna give them licking. But it was kind of funny, you know, but I think honestly, you know, the way we talk about licking nowadays is a little bit different, you know. I remember getting dirty lickings, but, you know, I don't think we do that to our kids nowadays, you know. Maybe we do, but, not to the point where they get bruises. You know what I mean? It's kind of like, hey, don't touch the stove. Don't touch the stove. And then, you know, and then that's pretty much it. But, you know, sometimes, like, I think it was, who was talking about it? Nolan Tong, yeah? He was talking about getting lickings. But, yeah, that stuff is, it's hard because I feel like getting licking was kind of helpful for me.
Yeah, sometimes it needs to happen too, man.
Yeah, I don't know. You know, the society says no good. But yeah, I just read this thing and said that you know, yeah, I got spanked when I was a child and I suffer from having respect for others.
Yeah, I saw that. I saw that meme too. Yeah. I suffer from having respect.
It's funny. Anyway, I don't know.